Hello there, KStevMath here again with another math video for Algebra 1. This is the fourth in my series, and the fourth of this first unit on solving linear equations. And this is really, I think, where it gets the most complicated that we're gonna see on solving linear equations, at least for right now. This is called solving multi-step linear equations, and I actually mentioned in the video for last lesson, you know, we did one-step equations and we did two-step equations, and then after that, it's not like we just keep calling them three-step, four-step, five-step, and so on. Partially because there are slightly different ways that you could choose to do it, or there are ways to kind of combine some steps or to take longer with steps so that it just gets trickier to count how many there are. So that's why they're called multi-step, to imply that, you know, there's more than two steps and you can kind of choose how you want to go about it. In some ways, we are going to have a kind of best ways to go about them that you'll see. And here's your quick reminder that I have a notes page for this that you can print off of my website, which should pop up in the corner, a link for you to get there so that you can do that. That way you don't have to write down all of this stuff on your own. You can just fill in what you want to fill in as you're working through the examples with me. I want to start off with a nice warm-up that's going to help us get in the right mindset for doing some of these problems. And if you look at this warm-up, what's different about this than maybe what we've been doing in the past few lessons is we've got some parentheses here. We did have parentheses in one lesson, but in that lesson I talked about how distributing isn't always the best idea, that sometimes dividing by whatever's in front of the parentheses in an equation actually makes things easier. But in this lesson, we're gonna find that distributing is the right way to go. So I wanted us to warm up and basically remember how to do the distributive property. So the distributive property says that if there's a number on the outside that is right next to the outside of the parentheses, so it's showing that this is multiplication here, two times this parentheses, then that means that all of the things in the parentheses need to get multiplied by whatever that number is. So for instance, I need to do 2 times 3x, but I also need to do 2 times negative 5. And you'll often see teachers and then students draw arrows to point this out to themselves that, hey, I want to do 2 times both of these things. I think it looks cool to do it, and it does also, it also can help you just remember to distribute it to both things. So 2 times 3x, whenever we do that, we multiply the 2 and the 3 together, and then the x just comes along for the ride. Think of it like we're saying we have twice as many as 3x, which means that we would have 6 x's. Remember the xylophone thing? So if I have 3 xylophones and I get twice as many xylophones, I have 6 xylophones. So that's 6x. Then I'm going to do 2 times negative 5, make sure you pay attention to the fact that this minus sign is here, and I get a minus 10. So if you were like, I don't remember how to distribute, and now you remember, you might think about pausing and trying the next one on your own. But hey, no worries, we can go through this together and that's fine too. So negative 6, I want to distribute, so I actually like to wait to draw the arrows until I'm actually on that step, so I like to do the arrow and say, okay, I'm going to do negative 6 times y, since y doesn't have a number in front, which is also known as a coefficient. It just gets the negative 6. It would be like if we were a 1 there, negative 6 times 1 is negative 6. So this is negative 6y. Now that I'm ready to do the next one, that's when I like to draw this arrow. So negative 6 times 10 is negative 60. And the reason I mentioned that is because I can't tell you how many times I've seen students that have the arrows drawn and then did not actually distribute all the way through because they just drew the arrows first and then forgot to follow through. It happens. Don't let it happen to you. All right, this third one has this minus 10 at the end that makes it different than the first two. And so this isn't just that we're going to distribute, we're also going to have to add some like terms, which is something that we went over, I believe, in the previous video. So I want to distribute this 5, and then once I'm done, I'm gonna minus 10 from anything that I can, whatever is like terms. And this is where our order of operations matters, because I want to do this multiplication that's happening first, before I do the subtraction for 10, because multiplication has a weightier priority than the minus 10 does. So I'm going to do 5 times negative 2n and get negative 10 n, and then 5 times 7, which is 35. And then that's this part right here, so I need to finish by writing the next part, minus 10. And then I have to ask myself, okay, what can I actually combine here because of like terms? Since we have negative 10 n and there aren't any other n's, it's going to stay the exact same and still be negative 10 n. And then 35 and minus 10, those can combine by subtracting them, and that gives us 25. And that's our answer. I boxed that one, and now I feel like I have to box the other ones, so that's just how it goes sometimes. Now, let's look at what our equations are going to be like. Let's talk about like our kind of our best order of which to do things. If you download the notes page and printed it off, then you already know what our examples are going to look like because you can just glance down to the next part of the page. If not, you'll see in just a moment what these equations are going to look like that we consider multi-step. But here's the order that it is best to handle these kind of complicated equations. And you don't always do every single one of these steps, but if you do need to do them, this is the best order to do it, to hopefully not accidentally commit some sort of math error that you didn't realize you were committing. So the very first thing is, if you see parentheses, it is safest, if it's a complicated equation, to go ahead and distribute so that you don't have to keep those parentheses. We did, during the two-step equation lesson, talk about how you can divide by the number in front of the parentheses, but that in these, since our equation is going to have more terms and more numbers and things like that, it's a little trickier and it's less likely to be helpful to try to do that. And I'll show you that on our examples, why exactly that is. So we're going to just first off distribute to get rid of parentheses. Once we've gotten rid of our parentheses, we're going to look at each side individually and say, are there things that I can combine because there's like terms? So we'll look on the left side and say, okay, are there like terms over here? And then we'll look at the right side and we'll say, okay, are there like terms over here? And if so, we'll combine those. Once we've got that done, our equation should look like what it did last lesson, where we will most likely have a variable on each side and a number on each side because we've combined all like terms. So we won't have more than that, but we should have that on each side. And so once we're there, then it's time to get the variables together, get the numbers together, and finish solving like what we've been doing. So this is definitely a situation where we are building off of what we did before. And so if you start looking at this and you're like, okay, I don't know that I got the last lesson because this just seems super hard, that's where you go back and practice more, or just really try to pay attention, because I'm going to try to explain every single thing that I'm doing, and so hopefully that will help. A kind of quick note about these examples, they are going to get longer as we go and more complicated as we go, so it does kind of build in difficulty, which means that if you're trying to, you know, pause and work ahead, that's great, but if you're like, well, this one looks more complicated, I don't know what to do, then that was actually kind of intended. There are still the now you try at the end that are not any more complicated than the examples are before them. So you do have that opportunity to try. Quick reminder, you can speed up the video or slow it down. If you're on YouTube, there's a little gear icon that lets you adjust how fast it's going. So if you're like, man, you are going so slow, you can speed it up, or if you feel like I'm going super fast, you can slow it down. You can always pause the video and catch up on writing if you need to, or even skip ahead if you're like, okay, well, I just need to know what the right answer is. That's the beauty of learning from a video. You have so much control. I mean, you could mute me if you wanted to, although that probably won't help a ton, but you could. You have that power. Go ahead, try it out. See, you can't hear what I'm saying right now. Right? Have you turned it back on? I'm going to assume you've turned it back on. Okay, let's do this example. So you can see that we've got parentheses here. And I said in the last slide, we're going to do the parentheses first. And before I actually do them, though, I do want to quickly mention the idea of we could divide both sides by this 4 instead of distributing the 4. But the problem with that is that these don't divide by 4 evenly. So we'll have fractions, which are not necessarily a bad thing, but it is something that we actually will be able to avoid if we choose to distribute instead. So that's why distributing is my best option for now. So I'm going to distribute 4 into this parentheses. 4 times 3x is 12x. And 4 times negative 8 is negative 32. And there's not any parentheses on the right side. There's not anything really I can do on that side. So I just rewrite it again. And our next step, which is to add like terms on each side, we don't have like terms. So the 12x minus 32, one has an x, one has a number, so those can't be combined. And on the right side, negative 3x and negative 2 aren't like terms, so those have to stay. We're ready to move on to the third step, which is getting x together and getting our numbers together. So it doesn't matter which way you go. You can go ahead and subtract the 12x over to the right, or I can add 3x over to the left. Remember, I used the opposite operation. So I'm going to add 3x over to the side. And if you're not ready for this, then you can go ahead and write stuff down and then go on. But I feel ready to go ahead and add the 32 over to the right side on the same step. And so that means I've got 15x, because that's 12x plus 3x, equals negative 2 plus 32, which is 30. And now my final step is to go ahead and keep working to isolate this x. So I'm going to divide both sides by 15, and I get the answer x equals 2. So how was that? Not too bad. Not too much more complicated than what we did last lesson. But we're going to see that there's going to be more things each of these examples that I do. So get ready for example 1b. All right, here we have example 1b, and we want to go through those steps again. So starting off, our eyes are supposed to be drawn to the parentheses. This time they're on the right side. That's going to be fine. We're just going to take this 3, and I'm going to distribute it here. So 3 times 2x is 6x. And I'm going to distribute it here. 3 times negative 7 is negative 21. So that's this part of the equation, and everything else around it needs to be dropped down, and it needs to look exactly the same. Just the only thing that should change is the 3 parentheses 2x minus 7 close parentheses. That's changing to 6x minus 21. So I should have this equal sign drop down, this minus 7, this minus x, and on the right side of what I wrote, I should have this plus 14 drop down. So that's the first step, get rid of parentheses. Again, dividing by 3 here is not going to actually be helpful, more helpful than what we did, because we would have to not only divide the left side by 3, but we also have something else on the right side that would have to get divided by 3. So really, if you're not sure that you can divide, sorry, if you're not sure that you're allowed to divide by the number in front of your parentheses in an equation, then your best bet is probably to distribute instead. So just as a general rule, at least for right now where you are in algebra 1. Now let's look at step 2, add like terms if we have them. So the left side doesn't have any, that's negative x minus 7. The right side has these two numbers which can be put together. So negative 21 plus 14 is negative 7. So this is 6x minus 7. Our next step is that we want to get our x's together and our numbers on the other side together. So either we need to add x over or subtract 6 over. I'm going to add x over to keep that positive thing I've got going on, positives are way better than negatives, right? And then that means that I would add this 7 over to this side. But wait, you may be alarmed by what happens because this plus 7 cancels out there as well, which means we've got 7x, but what does 7x equal? If we get rid of everything on one side or the other of an equation in this manner, then that means that we would have a 0 there because we got rid of the negative x, we got rid of the negative 7, now we have nothing, but nothing has a number that represents it. Nothing is 0. So now I can say, well, I need to divide by 7, which gives me 0. Now, thanks to, I don't even know when exactly this happens, there's this confusion a lot of times between which of these is okay and which of these is not okay. You are allowed to have 0 on top of a fraction. 0 divided by 7 is 0. You're not allowed to have 0 on the bottom of a fraction and get an answer. We call this undefined. And here's why. 0 divided by 7 is saying that you have 0 of something and you are trying to divide it into 7 groups. So if you take 0 and divide it into 7 groups, each of those 7 groups will still have 0. So it maybe doesn't make a lot of sense to try to divide 0 things into groups, but you can. They each get 0. Whereas if you have 7 divided by 0, it's saying, I have 7 things and I want to put them into 0 groups. Well, wait, you can't take things and put them into no groups. I mean, that means you're not actually doing a thing. So that question just doesn't make sense, which is why we call it undefined. And that's going to be important to us in the next unit, whenever we're talking about graphing and slope and stuff like that. But for now, it just, if you looked at 0 divided by 7 and were like, I don't know if I can do that, yes, you can. 0 on top is fine. If you haven't asked Siri what 0 divided by 0 is, by the way, you should do that because it's funny. If you have the ability to ask Siri because you have some sort of Apple product. But I don't know, maybe other ones have interesting answers too. So, I mean, by all means, ask Alexa, ask Cortana, ask whoever else there is out there. Here we are in example 2a, and like I said, it's getting more complicated because now we have not just one set of parentheses, but 2 sets of parentheses. So we're going to distribute on each of these. We're really going to treat this like it's kind of 2 different things we're doing. When I distribute the 4 over on here, like that doesn't affect anything else in the equation, it just affects this part right here. So I'm going to do 4 times negative 5x and get negative 20x. And then I'm going to do 4 times 7 and get 28. And that's everything that's on the left side. So I need to equals. And I'm going to do the same thing with this negative 5. I'm going to distribute it here. It does not get distributed to the 73. It does not get distributed to the 73, which is good because I don't want to do negative 5 times 73. Negative 5 times negative 3x, though, that's a positive 15x, because 2 negatives make a positive in math, English, and not in life. Negative 5 times 2 gives us negative 10. And then we put that at 73 at the end. Now, we've gotten rid of parentheses. We check for like terms. The left side doesn't have like terms, but the right side does. I can put negative 10 and positive 73 together. So everything else needs to stay the same. It's important that you pay a lot of attention as you're rewriting. Like I almost just wrote 128 instead of 28, which would have been bad. Because lots of mistakes can happen just from not rewriting the next line correctly. Negative 10 plus 73 is 63. Now I want to get my variables on one side and my numbers on the other. So I'm going to choose to add 20x. Over here, which makes this go away, and then I'm going to subtract 63 to this side, which makes this go away. Ooh, 28 minus 63. So we actually do it the other way around and have to borrow, so that gives us 35, but it's negative because the 63 was the bigger number and was negative. So negative 35 equals 35x. Well, hey, conveniently enough, that divides nicely. And so we get x equals negative 1 as our answer, because dividing, when you're dividing, if one of them is negative, it makes your answer a negative. If two of them are negative, it makes it positive. If they're both positive, it makes it positive. Okay, this is the final example, and as far as multi-step equations go, this is about as complicated as I think it usually gets. And by all means, we could add more numbers and stuff on each side, another set of parentheses or two, but I think that for the most part, this is about as complicated as you should see it. And really, even this is going above and beyond what is really truly necessary. If you have a test over solving equations, I would expect that if there are any that are this complicated, there would only be one. And because it's not as easy to, they're not as easy to do, they're not as important to be able to do. Most of the equations we end up solving for our word problems, which will be a later lesson, are going to be a lot simpler than this. So it's can be a kind of a fun exercise to do complicated equations like this, but at least at this point in our math life, it's not necessarily super duper 100% important that we can do one of these every single time. That being said, you can do this. What you already know, we can apply to this and get the correct answer. We just have to be able to, you know, pay attention and keep track of our numbers and work at it and persevere. So let's distribute on the left this negative 2. Negative 2 times negative 3y is positive 6y. And then let's distribute negative 2 times 5, which is negative 10. That's this part right here, so I need to go ahead and write this plus 5 down. Then I'm going to do this 2 and get 2 times negative 5y, which is negative 10y. And then 2 times negative 1, which is negative 2. And so that's this part right here. So I need to put the minus 51. Now, you might be able to combine some steps here, but you need to practice enough to know whether or not that's something that you can do safely. So practice enough where you can see if you've got the right answer or not. For instance, you may be thinking, well, I already know that I'm going to get the y's together, so I can do that on the same step that I add like terms. I don't suggest doing that. I think you should keep them separate, but by all means, if you feel like you can do that, go for it. I'm going to add like terms. Negative 10 plus 5 is negative 5. So there's like terms, and here's like terms. But the 6y and the negative 10y, for now, don't change. Negative 2 minus 51 is negative 53. So now I want to get the y's together and the numbers together. By the way, notice that when we're adding like terms, when I do the negative 10 and the plus 5 together, I didn't change the operations happening there like I do whenever I move things across the equal sign. So it's essentially like we're ignoring one half of the equation and saying, is there anything I can just do with this right here to make this simpler? And so that's why we don't have to do opposite operations. Whereas now that we have everything as simple as we can get it, now we're going to have to do the opposite and add 10y so that it moves from the right, and do the opposite by adding 5 so that it moves from the left. That gives me 16y equals negative 48. And then we divide both sides by 16. Now this is a tricky one. I know it's negative because one of the numbers is negative, and I actually know what it is off of the top of my head because of how much math I do. But if you didn't know, or if you don't know, you could just try simplifying this. Like, they are, both of these numbers are divisible by 2, so I could say, well, if I divide them both by 2, that gives me negative 24 over 8, which is an easier division problem to do. That gives us 3, or negative 3, and so that can be a way that if you can tell something can be reduced but don't know if it divides evenly, that's a way you can check without having to resort to using your calculator. Since, you know, if you're not allowed to use a calculator in Algebra 1, which lots of people aren't, then using it on your homework isn't helpful if you use it as a crutch so that you would need it on the test or quiz as well. So just keep that in mind. All right, we've reached the now you try. So two problems here, A and B, for you to try on your own. Pause the video, start it back up when you're ready. If you can't make it through the whole problem successfully, that's fine. If you've got a friend, sibling, parent, other relative, other acquaintance, someone who can maybe help you find your mistake and figure out what you're doing wrong, that's great. If you don't have one of those people but you would like to leave a comment below so that I can try to help you, that's a great idea. But do at least try and see how far you can get, because I feel like you should at least be able to do the first step, maybe even the first two steps, or kind of some combination before you get stuck if you've been paying attention. So pause, and then when you start it back up, I'll be working on this problem. That was done. Okay, so first step is to distribute this 3. So everything else stays the same. X minus 4 equals 3 times negative 4x is negative 12x. 3 times 1 is 3. And don't forget this plus 6 at the end. That's an easy mistake to make. Now I look for like terms, which I have some right here. 3 plus 6 is 9. And then we want to get our x's together and our numbers together. If at some point you're doing these problems and you're like, wow, this just feels really repetitive, and you're also getting the right answer consistently, that is a good sign that you have done enough practice, at least for now. You can always do more practice to make sure it sticks in your head. Now I'm adding 4 to both sides, but as far as if it feels repetitive, hopefully that means that you've gone through the steps enough to be like, okay, I can see that there's a pattern, there's a consistency. It's not like I'm doing something different every single time. That's not how it should feel. We're solving equations. It kind of works the same the majority of the time. There are patterns. So then we divide by 13 on both sides and get x equals 1. If you feel like you learned something from that one and have not yet done B, you should try B on your own and then start the video back up and see how it went. Okay, so this one is another one that this is about as complicated, I feel like, as it gets. So I'm going to distribute one time on each side and then add like terms and then do all the rest. So if at any point you figure out a mistake you made and want to pause so you can try the rest of the problem again, that's a great idea, because this is the last one of these that we'll do together before I send you off to do these completely on your own away from me. I'm so proud. So negative 2 times 3x is negative 6x, and negative 2 times 7 is negative 14. This negative 5 needs to drop down, and then I'm going to distribute this 4. 4 times 4x is 16x, 4 times 11 is 44, and I'm going to add this 25. Now I'm going to add like terms, so I've got this and this to add together, not to each other, but like negative 14 minus 5 is negative 19, and 44 plus 25 is 69, and now I'm going to put the x's together and the numbers together. So I'm going to add the 6x over here and subtract 69 over here, and this gives me negative 88 equals 22x. I'm going to divide both sides by 22 and get my answer, which is negative 4. So how'd you do? That's another thing you could tell me in the comments, because I'd love to know how it's going for you. Here's this lesson's challenge problem. So it looks a little similar to what we've done already, but there is something different that happens here that is likely to throw you off. And if you think you know what to do about it, or if you think you have the answer, please comment below and I will let you know. But if you are just like, I have no idea, because this is completely different than what we just did, that's okay. The next video, this is what we're actually going to go over. is what's going to happen, what happens some of the time. It hasn't happened to us in any of the problems I've done in these videos so far, but it can happen to us, and I want us to address that. So here's your challenge. Give it a shot. See if you can get the right answer, or an answer in general is also fine. Get something. Do something. Finally, thank you so much for watching. I have a really cool website that I've been working on for a while now that I'm really picking up steam on. If you go there, link in the description, or the just general link is on the screen, like probably right above my head right now. If you go there, you can find all sorts of resources. I'm adding resources daily. For this lesson in particular, if you went and printed out the notes page, then you know, are a super cool person for doing that. There's also a practice page you can print out. And there's also this cool app, which probably is appearing on the screen right now, that you can use to give you new problems to practice where you would know what the right answer is. And in fact, I made the app before I made this lesson because I did not want to have to make the problems up on my own. I programmed the app so that it would give me relatively nice numbers that all worked out, and then I just clicked the new problem button and until I got ones that I liked. And so I'm pretty proud of myself there for doing that and using that. And you can use that too. You can go and it does, it's not a put in an answer and see if you're right thing. It's just a, here's a problem, you know, write it down, work it out, get an answer, and then click the show answer button and see if you're right. And that way you're getting some immediate feedback. If you're not getting it right, then you're gonna have to get someone to help you, which could be a parent, guardian, sibling, other relation, friend, tutor, or, you know, I haven't mentioned this lately, but I do have a Twitter account at KStevMath. And I'll put a link to that or a thing to that in the description as well. If you are ever stuck on a math problem that you need help on, you could tweet me a picture and I would hopefully be able to help you figure out what your mistake is. Unless people start doing that all the time, and then that might take up too much time, but I can try. So like I said, thanks for watching. Please subscribe, please like, please give me a comment, and I'll see you in the next video.